Camel Rock is a pretty popular spot, and every time you come, there's a different amount of sand in the foreground, and so you get a completely different shot. Well, not completely different. The rocks are still the same. We got here very early this morning. It's a weekday, so not too busy. Sometimes you can find a dozen or so photographers here, so make sure you get early to mark a spot. What I'm capturing here are pixels. So I've got the scene set up, and I've got all this wave motion happening. And sometimes the photos of the waves in the background aren't as good as they are in the foreground and vice versa. So what I'm doing is I'm capturing a series of photographs, and then later on in post-production, I can stack them all together and just rub in or paint in the bits of the photo that I like the best. It's important to keep the camera locked off on a tripod so nothing moves, and all that's happening is that the action like this is happening in the background, and that'll give me the option later on. I'm also hoping, but just hoping, that maybe the sun's going to break through that cloud over there, just going to paint the top of those rocks. Unfortunately this morning, I'm looking at this and thinking maybe, maybe not, but you never, never know if you never, never go. The only problem with this technique of capturing pixels is that once you've locked the camera off on a tripod, there's not much else you can do. So I'm sitting here waiting for the light, and looking at the time, it's not looking great, but that's the problem. Once you've got the camera there, it's set, it's locked off, you can't go and take other photos. That's a good reason for having a drone or a second camera. In the interest of good technique, I probably should be using a remote here on the camera, but the camera is locked off on a rather sturdy tripod, and so I'm pressing the shutter very gently so as not to disturb the camera during the exposure. However, a remote control or one of your little wireless apps, the Fuji has a great little wireless app, I could be sitting here pressing the button, but I'm old school. It's actually a really nice sky this morning. We've got the cloud coming down and sort of mirroring the peak of Camel Rock, and a little bit of blue sky off to the side. So in terms of post-production, it's a nice sky to work with, and I think there's quite a bit of potential. We haven't had the sunrise this morning, so we're going to have to go to plan B. When you don't get nature cooperating completely, post-production can be a great help. So this is the image as I see it. A lot of people ask me, when I go out and take photographs, you know, do I know what it's going to look like at the end? And the answer is yes, no, and sometimes. On this occasion, I had a bit of an idea of what I wanted, and what I wanted was some detail in Camel Rock. I wanted to have a really good-looking sky, and I also needed detail in the foreground rocks, which leads the eye into the composition. So looking at this, what was my starting point? As you can see from here, it was quite a bit different. Let's go and have a look at the four exposures that I've chosen to work together into the final composite image. This exposure is taken because of the water. So I'm looking at my photograph in different areas. I'm looking at the middle of the water, I'm looking at the sky, Camel Rock, and the foreground. And in the middle water here, I'm using quite a long exposure, you know, several seconds, and the water has gone this wonderful milky white, and I like that. Not everybody does. If you don't like the milkiness, then you use a shorter shutter speed, but I like the milkiness, and that's part of the image that I want to emphasize. That was shot number 190, shot number 206. This is a photograph where it's a much shorter shutter speed. You can see that there's not much movement in the water itself, and the foreground you can see is well exposed. And I've obviously processed these raw files out to give me the exposure values that I want. So I've lightened up my photograph here so that I've got detail in the rocks. And you can also see a little pool of water just there in the foreground. We'll lighten that up a little bit more later on in proceedings. The third image is the one for the sky. And that was a little bit underexposed while I was there. By underexposed, I exposed it correctly for the sky, but the correct exposure for the sky was a little bit too dark for the rest of the scene. And as you can see, the foreground isn't particularly wonderful. And then the last one, and this was while we were waiting for the sun to come out. And the sun never quite made it, but we did get some nice illumination through the clouds. And when we enlarged this up, let's see if I can do that quickly for you here. When we enlarge it up, you can see that I do have some wonderful light and detail in Camel Rock itself. And so that there, the four images. Now, I suppose the question that some people would ask is, well, why don't you just get it in one shot? And the answer is that in one shot, I've got the sky, the rocks and the water. You know, they're frozen in time, whereas here I'm choosing different parts of time to join it together. So in some ways, I'm creating a reality that never existed. But in other ways, I'm taking the best bits of the scene that was in front of me and joining them together for that perfect picture postcard photograph. As you can see, we're working in Photoshop, and if we're going to work with layers, then we do need to use Photoshop because Lightroom and even Capture One, they don't allow us to have image layers. I mean, Capture One and Lightroom have adjustment layers of sorts. They have the adjustment brush, gradient tool, and that sort of stuff, but only Photoshop gives us access to image layers. And I want to get these four images and put them into a layer stack. And the quickest way to do that is actually to come over here to Photoshop and come down to Scripts. And there's a little script here called Load Files into Stack. And that looks pretty easy. And you can see here I can either browse for the files, but it also says Add Open Files. And as I've got the four photographs already open, I'm just going to click Add Open Files. OK, and Photoshop's going to go to work and do it all for me. And I love automation. So with the images stacked, let's just see what order they're in. So I'm just going to turn them off one at a time. And that's my base image. But the photo that I like at the bottom, no particular reason except, you know, the sky is going to be the furthest away. And that's that sky. I like that sunrise sky. So I'm just going to grab that layer and drag it down to the bottom. So when I turn that layer on the top off, I've still got my three layers there above this bottom layer, but that's my ground, that's my starting point. Next thing, so I perhaps want to lighten up that foreground. And if I come up here to number 206 and I click and I turn that on, you can see that lightens it up. That's great. So I'm going to drag that down on top. And now I'm going to go and add a layer mask. So the mask is a little icon down here, the square with the hole in the middle. I click on that, that adds a mask. The mask you can see at the moment is white. White reveals, so the whole of the image is visible. If I now invert that mask, so I make the mask black, now you can't see any of it. But if I grab my brush tool and then making sure that I've got a white brush, I can paint in. Let me just enlarge this up a little bit and just paint in. Now I use a big brush. And with the brush settings, you also see they've got the hardness of zero. So a big brush, hardness of zero, and I'm just painting in all of the foreground. And so you can see now that when I turn this layer on and off, it's sort of like painting with light. It's like going down there early in the morning with a flashlight and just lightening up the foreground. So there's two layers, and we're sort of getting there. My next step is I just want to add in that beautiful soft water that I had. So when we turn on the next layer, you'll see, no, that's not it. Turn on the top layer, that's it. All right, so now that I know which layer it is, just drag it down. And this little eye icon allows us to turn the layer on and off. So you can see that when it's off, there it's on. But I've lost everything that way. So what I'm going to do is add in a mask. And with the mask, I'm going to invert it. And then with a white brush again, because white reveals, I'm just going to brush straight across the middle like that. And you can see I haven't had to do too much. And I'm going a little bit up into that sky, as you can see as I turn that on and off. But that's one of the, you know, because the tripod has been, the camera's been locked off on the tripod, nothing's moved. I can then just go back to a black brush and then just paint that back in a little bit across the top there like that, you can see. And so now, there I've got the beautiful water. So we've got three out of the four components. For that final component, let's just go and turn that top layer on. You can see the detail coming into the rock. Let's go and click on that layer, add in a mask, invert the mask, get a white brush, and paint over the top of the rock. So as I paint there, you'll see, well, that's not a particularly good job, but let's just enlarge it up. Now just go up here, go to my navigator, and we can see it there, it's a little bit too big. And you can see I'm bringing in the sky from that particular shot. Now that's not necessarily a bad thing, but it does look a little bit odd. So let's do a little bit of handiwork, make my brush black, and we can paint back in. And so it's going to be one of these jobs which I'm not going to do all on the screen now, but it will take a little bit of time just to get it exactly right. And you'll use a smaller size brush. So here I'm coming down, I've got a very small brush, make it white, and I can just paint in the areas there that you can see bit by bit. Now, the light is coming from the left, so I'm going to paint in on the left, but I'm not going to go all the way over to the right, because if I go all the way over to the right, it'll just give me a flat rendition. I want to keep that 3D molding in there to some extent. So we're just going to paint the left-hand sides of the rock mainly, just to create that sense of the sun coming up early in the morning. And so if we say that that's just almost there, let's go and resize that. Or you can turn it on and off, and you can see how I'm just adding in a little bit of detail there. I'm mucking up the foreground there, aren't I? Don't you love Photoshop layers? Get my black brush and just paint that out. There we go. That's nice. And we're almost there. To add a little bit more interest to the photograph, I just want to lighten up the little rock pool in the foreground. So I'm going to come down in my layer stack, and I'm going to find the layer that has the rock pool. I'll turn that on and off, and you can see, so I'm on the right layer. Then I'm going to add in a curves adjustment layer, but it could be levels, could be anything else you like. Just readjust this so you can see my curve. And then looking at the rock pool in the foreground, I'm going to adjust my curve. So I'm going to grab the white point and move that to the left. And I'm going to grab a point halfway along, just lighten that up a little bit, and then drop it down. Now, obviously, as I'm doing this, I'm adjusting the whole image, but I only want to adjust the particular layer that we're working on. So with that adjustment layer highlighted, I come up and I come down to create clipping mask. And you'll see that it gets indented with that little arrow. And now when I'm making the adjustment, it's only affecting the layer immediately below, not the bottom layer as well, which is what we want. But then secondly, I don't want to lighten up all of the rocks. I just want to lighten up the rock pool. So let's go back to my mask. I'm going to invert that mask. I'm going to make sure I've got a white brush, and I'm just going to paint in that little bit of the rock pool. And you know, normally I'm never going to just try and go hard around the edges. I'm going to paint in that general area. In fact, I'm putting a diagonal right through the middle there. I'll turn that on and off, and you can see how that's lightening up the image. So at this stage I would save the file, but then to work a little bit further, let's just flatten it. So I'm going to go to layer, and I'm going to flatten the image completely. So now I've just got that single image, and I'm looking at the composition. And what I would like is when I look at a vertical 2:3 ratio photograph, I find it's a little bit long and thin, and I prefer a 4:5 ratio. So if I get my crop tool out and I go and set it to, you know, 4:5, when I crop the picture, what I find is that I'm losing the bottom of that pool. And that annoys me. I want to keep the sky in up the top, but I don't want to lose the bottom of the pool. So what can I do? Well, let's just leave that tool for the moment. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab my get a selection tool here, and I'm just going to grab the bottom area. I'm going to free transform it. So I'm pressing Ctrl+T or Command+T on a Mac, and I'm just pushing this section up. So I'm not losing anything, I'm just compressing it. And I'll press OK. So at this stage I will deselect, and that's Control or Command+D. Then I grab my crop tool, and I set the ratio up to 4:5, make sure it's still there, it shouldn't have changed. And then now when I crop down, I find that I managed to keep that little rock pool in the foreground. And I can just click OK, and now I'm happy. I've got the rock pool in a good position relative to the Camel Rocks in the background. Okay, how do we finish the picture off? Along with a couple of adjustment layers, of course. So I like using curves adjustment layers, so I'm going to add in a curves adjustment layer. I'm going to try and vignette the outside of the picture just a little bit, so I just darken down the image. And then what I do is I invert the mask again. I get out a white brush. And looking at the picture, rather than just doing a circle, I'm actually just going to paint in the edges a little bit. When it comes down to this foreground rock, I might paint the hole at a bit of a diagonal there, just paint in a little bit of the outside there. And so when you turn that on and off, you can see that I'm just darkening the edges, containing the eye within. And then we can work the other way as well. I can add in another curves adjustment layer. And this time I might just grab the white point and just move it a little bit to the left. So I'm just lightening up that image. Just put a little bit of sparkle in there, invert the mask, make my brush a little bit bigger, and I'm just going to paint in some light just like that there. And I could possibly come back and just lighten that up a little bit more. There we go, that's looking pretty good. So if we turn those on and off, you can see that Camel Rock didn't look too bad this morning, did it? That's it. That's a couple of little tricks and steps in Photoshop and post-production. And I think you can see now why, for me, photography is all about capture and post-production. The post-production is just such an important part.